Hugh Hefner. He turned silk pajamas into a work uniform, women into centerfolds, and sexual desire into a worldwide multimedia empire.
Made a lot of money. Well, now we're marking his death. The Playboy founder died yesterday at the age of 91. NBC's Erica Edwards takes a look back on his somewhat controversial life.
It's time for the guys and girls get back together.
Hugh Hefner was never far from female companionship or controversy.
Hugh Hefner built his empire off of selling the idea that human sexuality is a commodity to be bought and sold.
But by Hefner's own account, what he sold in his issues of Playboy magazine was sophisticated anti-Puritanism.
That nudity itself is still big news in America is good for business, but also says a great deal about how unsophisticated we are in terms of sex.
Both Hugh Marston Hefner and his magazine were born in Chicago. The first issue of Playboy quickly sold out when it hit newsstands in 1953, thanks to a nude photograph of Marilyn Monroe included as the centerfold. Subsequent issues had the same success, launching an entertainment empire. By the end of the decade, Playboy was selling more than 1 million copies a month. In the 1970s, Hef, as he was called, moved west, buying a home in Los Angeles that became known as the Playboy Mansion. The wild parties at the mansion became notorious for their scantily clad guests and risque behavior. But the 80s saw a switch in Hugh Hefner's lifestyle. In 1989, the Ultimate Bachelor married Playmate of the Year Kimberly Conrad, his second marriage after a failed one some 30 years earlier.
This is a unique celebration.
The couple separated in 1998, but remained married until the youngest of their two sons turned 18. During his separation from Conrad, Hef rebounded by dating up to 7 women at once, but eventually narrowed it down to 3. And in 2005, the group starred in the popular reality show The Girls Next Door. The hit show relaunched Hefner's Playboy lifestyle to a whole new audience and made his mansion the hangout of a new breed of Hollywood A-listers. Hugh Hefner was a figure of unchecked hedonism and exploitation. To others, he was a window to the good life. But no one can deny that Hef left an indelible stamp on publishing and pop culture.
It's nice to be remembered.
Erica Edwards, NBC News.
Hugh Hefner's family says he died peacefully of natural causes at his home, the Playboy Mansion. Tim?
It's been more than a week since Hurricane Maria scored its direct hit on Puerto Rico, obliterating vital infrastructure and plunging the American Commonwealth into a different kind of dark age. Melissa Colorado spoke to a Twin Cities doctor who just returned from the ravaged island, and she joins us now with more. Melissa?
Well, Tim, with every passing day, there is a new challenge for Puerto Ricans. Access to clean water, electricity, medical care, and cash gets harder and harder. And the Edina doctor we've been following for over a week says he had to come back to the Twin Cities because the conditions in Puerto Rico were taking a toll on his wife's health. Now, Dr. Miguel Fiol is a neurologist and a faculty member at the U of M. He was in San Juan vacationing and decided to ride out Hurricane Maria, knowing well his services would be needed in the aftermath. Dr. Fiol spent several days volunteering at an emergency shelter in the city's convention center, which serviced hundreds of evacuees. He says it was a challenge to treat patients because drugs to treat diabetes and hypertension are running out, and there was little electricity to power up medical equipment like ventilators. And if that's not all, Dr. Fiol fears over 3 million Puerto Ricans are vulnerable to waterborne diseases because of so much standing water and a shortage of clean water.
My concern is an epidemic because there's just no resources to deal. The health infrastructure is stretched to the limits, and that is my big concern. Waterborne illnesses.
And Dr. Fiol is teaming up with medical students at the U to raise awareness and collect donations for Puerto Rico. And more importantly, they're trying to get Minnesota companies to donate drugs and medical equipment that are now in short supply. And if you wish to help, we have more information on care11.com. Tim?
Thank you, Melissa. This week, the Air Force sent a medical team to St. Croix, the largest of the U.S. Virgin Islands, while some 50 patients were flown to Atlanta for additional medical care. And there are parts of Dominica that no longer exist after Hurricane Maria. U.S. sailors are using helicopters to move people from their island to Martinique and Guadeloupe.
A big step forward in the redevelopment of the former St. Paul Ford plant site. Last night, St. Paul City Council members approving the zoning plan for that site. The plan, which divided neighbors concerned about density, calls for 4,000 new residential units and business areas on 122 acres just off the Mississippi River. St. Paul city leaders are holding off on a proposal to restrict the sale of menthol cigarettes. The city talked about limiting menthol sales to tobacco shops, something the city of Minneapolis recently passed, trying to keep them out of the reach of young people. Last night, the city had a public hearing on that ordinance.
I don't have a car. I'm not going to take 9 buses to go buy a pack of cigarettes, but I'm also not going to quit because I'm an adult and that's my choice.
Tobacco kills more people in my community than anything else. We need you to help us in this cycle.
City is going to hold more talks with the community before it makes a final decision on that proposal. And St. Cloud is the latest city to consider making it illegal to sell tobacco to anyone under the age of 21. St. Paul, St. Cloud City Council set a public hearing for November 6th on that proposed ordinance. Edina and St. Louis Park have already raised the minimum age for tobacco sales to 21.
There'll be a funeral today for the Dassel-Cocato High School student who died from a sear reaction to a peanut allergy. 15-year-old Jacob McDonald died last Friday after the reaction caused severe heart and lung issues. Jacob's funeral is at 11 a.m. at the Holy Trinity Church of Winsted. One of two people charged in the death of Savannah Graywind is expected in court today. Brooke Cruz may enter a plea to charges of murder, kidnapping, and giving false information to officers. Her boyfriend, William Hain, pleaded not guilty to those very same charges yesterday. Graywind's newborn was found in their apartment days after Savannah went missing. Graywind's body was later found in the Red River.
More fallout from the federal investigation into bribery, corruption, and fraud in college basketball. University of Louisville placing head coach Rick Pitino on unpaid administrative leave. Pitino's attorney insists the coach has done nothing wrong, but he's already serving a suspension for a recruiting sex scandal last year.
Is this one scandal too many?
For Rick Pitino, yes. He's going to basically be viewed as someone that is polarizing to the point where nobody in college basketball is going to want any part of them.
Now, as for Louisville, the school itself, there's a risk the NCAA could issue the death penalty, so-called, banning the storied basketball program for at least a year.
Protests over the national anthem continue, spurred on by comments from President Trump. The Green Bay Packers are asking their fans at Lambeau Field for tonight's game against the Chicago Bears to join them in linking arms during the anthem. Last night, CNN hosted a town hall on the protests and racial inequality with NFL players and military members.
When those colors are raised, I'm going to salute. That does not mean that I believe America is perfect, but I believe the ideal of America is worth continuing to work for.
Treat people better. That's really what it's about. It's about treating people like human beings. That's the first step. The first step is to recognize and see somebody as an equal being when you recognize them.
So the conversation that Colin Kaepernick was originally hoping for when he did this in the first part appears to be happening.
Did Green Bay say what the purpose was in locking arms? Was that to show support for the national anthem? Was it to show support for the players? Did they say?
The way I heard it originally was Aaron Rodgers, their quarterback, asked the fans to do this in a way of showing support and just saying we have to address these issues. We have to talk about them head on. We're not going to find a solution any other way. So whether the Packers have issued a further statement, maybe. I'm not aware of that. I just heard it from Aaron Rodgers, which was originally the way I heard the story.
See what happens. Everybody's excited about one thing, and that is the good weather we had yesterday continuing today.
Beautiful day yesterday. Today, a little bit warmer. We'll be up closer to 70 degrees this afternoon, and pretty good news for half of the weekend. We got some changes on the way.
See a movie on Sunday, right?
Yeah.
And still keep an eye on this crash in the North Metro, 252 southbound, blocking the right shoulder. Doesn't seem like traffic's an issue in that area at this point. Another crash popped up along 694 near 35W southbound, also in the North Metro. More details on that coming up.
Of all the weekends, it's this one. Now the governor is even weighing in on the big 35W closure. Why MnDOT says they had no choice.
Parents weighing in on this. You want to get that newborn gunk off your baby when they're born, right? Some doctors say it's best for the baby to wait. It has some parents waiting a week before giving their newborn that first bath.
And fashion meeting Fido this morning. Dogs in the studio strutting their stuff and looking for forever homes.